Okay, very great. Hey, we're taping here. Even though we don't have a whole lot of views on the last video, people haven't had time to get to it yet. But everything's moving so fast. The urgency is just extreme. We're on the urgency committee here, to say the least. So, an idea came to me. The crucial dates are May 5th through October 15th. This is when there's going to be a blitzkrieg, psychological blitzkrieg in the world. And you're either going to shift, do make a psychological shift downwards into delay or upwards towards easing past all paranoia, actually. And that's going to happen in the next 5 months. So here, I just, the idea came to me. It never happened really like this. I just said, maybe I just, ask people, when I, random people in a gas station, if I happen to be there, somebody's there, somebody came talk to me today. I said, look, I'm here. I'll answer any question. If you just give me, I guess, well, I'll answer one question for you. Give me one question, I'll answer it for you. And if they are one bit of help, if you need something like that, something like that. And just be available to help random people, so to speak, or our serendipity based encounters. And, just start to spread some positivity in this way. Start to, so it seems like this is like an assignment maybe that I'm being given to do this and just help out. Who knows if I'll do it online or not, like a Zoom thing or something like that. And people can ask one question, not a bunch of questions, no follow-up either, no dialogue or discussion. That is a negative. That spirals you downwards. But ask a key question and then just listen to the answer. And take it to heart, that sort of thing. And then that's it. We don't want too much pressure on anyone. Discussions are not good. They're not good at all. Truth, here it seems like a paradox. And to be able to entertain this seeming paradox is extremely difficult. You have to be exquisitely trained to be able to handle this here. For instance, like you say, you're recognizing no need for success is instant success. The recognition that we don't need any success is instant success. See, that's kind of a paradox. And if you can, handle this, if psychologically you have the flexibility and space to accept this and practice it over and over and over to become familiar with it, which is the key. Familiarity is the key. People overlook this almost entirely. Almost entirely, they overlook familiarity. They think that just sort of conceptualizing something is enough, when in fact, that's just the tip of the iceberg. That's just the beginning of the work. So if you get a paradox like recognizing no need for success is instant success, successing, you need to practice it. You need to practice this and become familiar with this. Not just say, oh, I just had an epiphany. I just saw it. Oh, that's great. I see it now. That's just the tip of the iceberg. 90% of the work lies in front of you in terms of practicing it and instilling this through practice, repetitious practicing to become used to it. So recognizing no need for success is instant successing. Just shocked by no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just allowing no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just accepting no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just delighting in no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just loving no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just abiding in no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Just no need for success is instant successing. Wow. Wow. Like that. You get familiar. The iceberg beneath the water is the iceberg of familiarity, which breeds expectations. The little part of the iceberg above the water is just our conceptual, intellectual, emotional framework of oh, I got a feel of that. I got a feel of it. Okay, good. That's again just a small part, maybe 10%, 10% maybe of the situation. So the work involves the other 90%, the hard part. Yeah, it's kind of like landscaping and yard work. Holy cow, it's quite a work. So One question, you know, one question, just try to, what is most important, vital question you may have. And then get, you know, maybe I'll just have an answer. Who knows? Probably I'm a part of the professional class in the highest echelon of the professional class, which is putting practicing first, which is Dharma class. Dharma class is the practicing class and putting practicing first. So I'm part of that super confidence, you might say, super confident. And so, you know, able to give, you know, the super confident perspective, perhaps to people, I don't know, I haven't done it before, in social situations, I've never done it, I just act like an idiot. I just be quiet and schlep around like I'm nothing, you know, and remain invisible, basically. But who knows, maybe people want to hear something that just, maybe this will like elevate them or help move them towards making a positive psychological shift, which is, you know, difficult because we have to know how to stabilize ourselves temporarily so the shock of the shift doesn't turn into panic, confusion and panic. And that's, it's doable if you use the right technique. If you don't have any technique at all, then it's, you know, it's not really doable. It's not really doable. You're going to have a rough time and get into all sorts of trouble. So, the times are in such that we're either going to shift upwards or downwards, towards delay or towards easing past all delay. You know, it's like that. So it's life and death, and it's even beyond life and death. It's much more critical in life and death because when you shift downwards into more delay, you're talking about a whole cycle of delay potentially. You're talking about many, 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 many lifetimes of delay, cycles of birth and death. You're talking about buying into that. So that's, you know, horrible. And the other option is to ease past all delay. You're talking about no more birth and death, or at the most maybe just one time. That kind of situation. You're not into a cycle anymore. And so that is very, very, very auspicious. So it's going to be one or the other right now. You know, there's fence sitting isn't working very well during these times. As I just took a peek at the news, just at one issue. I mean, obviously the saber rattling is getting extremely intense. And this is what we've been warned about. This is what I've been talking about. It's just the escalation of saber rattling. Things are not getting better. They're getting a lot worse. So again, this next, 161 days from May 7th to October 15th is 161 days. These days are the crucial days, absolutely crucial. So I feel like I might be getting an assignment to just sort of make myself available. And it's sort of like a jubilee sort of situation where people, you know, kind of like whatever they want, they get sort of thing. If you want something, you know, I'll give it to you, that kind of thing. It's just kind of like throw all ideas of success out the window. It's just instant success. Kind of 5 months of getting used to instant successing. 5 months of getting used to instant successing. Because really, not realizing we don't need any success at all is instant success. It really is. See, that seems paradoxical, isn't it? But if you understand the context, it's not paradoxical at all. It just points out that in reality, we always have everything we want. So there's no need for quote-unquote success. Everything is instant success, which is kind of contradictory in itself, instant success. Nothing leads up to it, and there's nothing after it as far as of you know, less success. So there's no way to highlight success in reality. It's all perfectly successful without any possibility of it not being that. So there's no reason to put any words to it. You know, there's no need to put words to reality because there's no lack at all. So there's no need to contrast success and failure at all in reality, actually. Yeah, that is truly the case. But again, hearing this and conceptualizing it and getting a glimpse, feel of it, that's 10%. Okay, that's a good thing. It's a good thing. But it's only 10%. The rest of the work is what has to be done. And that stuff, it can be kind of repetitious. So repetitious, repeating it over and over, just instilling it in yourself, drilling it into yourself, just getting used to it. No need for success is instant success. I need to do nothing. I am like, wow. Just shock my no need for success is instant successing. I need to do nothing. I am like, wow. Ramana Padma Sambhava Longchampa Lotus Family. Wow. You see, you could say stuff like this: Ramana Padmasambhava Longchenpa Lotus Family Wow. Ramana Padmasambhava Longchenpa Lotus Family Wow. Ramana 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 Ramana. And I need instant success myself, because I just going for broke, literally went for broke. I have to be ready and available for this May 7th start to this blitzkrieg, 161-day blitzkrieg in the world. I had to be ready for it, so I just spared no expense and just pushed everything forward with extreme urgency. Ended up with not, you know, using no more money in the bank. It's gone. It's like, uh-oh. I need instant success with that. So literally went for broke. Literally. To be ready, Johnny on the spot at this time. And that's what we're called to be, Johnny on the spot here. If people, you know, want to have at least some, to have their concerns or something that's vitally important to them, they want it addressed, vitally important to them, well, maybe I'll say something, even though that produces vagueness ultimately, right? But it may, you know, I'm not exactly sure if it, what the plus minus equation is on all of that, if even saying anything actually. Maybe just be silent for the time of silence. Nothing needs to be said. Absolute confidence. That's possible too. Absolute confidence. Yeah. But we're certainly now, you know, that person at the driving range lost the head of his golf club. I've never seen that happen before. Never seen anything like that. The head just flew off his club, went flying about 100 yards down the driving range or something. It's like crazy. We stopped everybody. I say, hey guys, you know, hold up. And everybody held up. He said it too. And he went out there and found his head, golf head, but he was still trying to put it on later. I saw him hours later. He still, you know, it's like, he didn't know what to do. He was really like confounded, you know, it's like, what do I do? You know, gee, that's crazy. So he lost his head. And so that means, you know, we're going into a phase where people are going to lose their heads and throw away the momentum of thousands of years that we built up here on this planet. We built up momentum here for thousands of years towards easing past all paranoia, that our fear that if we stop pretending we won't know how to function. That's the fundamental paranoia that's holding all of us back. If it weren't for that, we would instantly drop all this nonsense, all this pretend. The universe would just instantly disappear, you might say. Be no more. If we all did that right this instant, we can. It's just our paranoia. It says, don't do it. You know, how will I function, you know, without the belief in process, time and space and place and process and all that stuff. So we continue believing in that, pretending in it, but don't have to. We don't have to. That's the key point. We don't have to. It's not necessary. So no need for success is instant successing. Wow. 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 I need to do nothing. I am like, wow. I need to do nothing. I am like, wow. I need to do nothing. I am like, wow. I need nothing. I am like, wow. But I need instant success. So, Ramana Padmasambhava Longchenpa Lotus Family, wow. Longchenpa Lotus Family, wow. Instant successing. Just easing into instant successing, wow. Just praising and exchanging. Let me see what you're saying. Just praising, exchanging all deficit, wow, for easing into instant successing, wow. Instant surplusing, wow. Just praising, exchanging all deficits now for easing into instant surplusing, wow. Instantly easing into surplusing, wow. Just praising and exchanging deficit, all deficiting now for instantly easing into surplusing, wow. Buddha care, for me right now. Just praising, exchanging, all deficiting for instantly easing into surplusing. Wow. Okay, so that would be a Buddha care practice right there. Padma Sambhava Longchenpa Lotus Family Wow. 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 So I don't know. People just have the, you know, if they can ask a question, mostly they can't ask questions, actually. They're not able to. They just basically set up a trap for you, you know, that kind of thing, instead of actually a legitimate question. So it's difficult. It might not work at all. Who knows? But you feel like you want to do something. You know, Jubilee period back in ancient times was when they just simply forgave all debt. All debtors out of prison, forgiven all debt. You know, part of the land is fallow. You know, they rotate that. But, you know, crimes are forgiven. Trespasses are forgiven. You get a restart. You get a cultural restart. I think it's like every 50 years or something. You get a cultural restart. That's a pretty good idea, you know. It's a very good idea, actually. All, you know, vengeance is forgiven. Everything is forgiven. You say, you know what? We're just going to start over. We're going to do a culture reset right now. It's healthy. I think that's healthy for our culture and our society to do a cultural reset. Not that we should necessarily. They let debtors out of prison. I don't know if they let everybody out. but the idea is, you know, you need psychologically, people just need to reset. So we're doing a great cultural reset right now. Started on February 20th, 2022 here, where we just say, you know what? It's okay to put practicing first. That's it. It's okay to put practicing first. So when our mind starts tripping out on all these stories we're telling ourselves, just say, oh, no, I'm going to put practicing first. Say, Padma Sambhava Longchenpa Lotus Family, wow. I need no success. All success is instanting, wow. No success is instanting, wow. No need for success is instanting, wow. No need for success is instant successing, wow. No need for success is instant successing, wow. Like that. So Buddha care for me-ing right now, instantly easing into surplusing. Wow. Buddha care for me-ing right now, instantly easing into surplusing. Wow. Buddha care for me-ing right now, instantly easing into surplusing. Wow. I talked to this guy today that's helped me, this laborer. He's amazing. He works so hard, and stuff he does is so difficult. Nobody will take his job. And I said, you know, I said, we're talking about the lottery and all these people gambling. He says, do you take the lottery? I said, no way. It's addictive. No. He says, yeah, you're right. Then don't touch this. It's bad, really bad. I said, people here are super addicted to it. They just, every day, they're just obsessed with it. I say, that's what happens. Gambling is horrible. He said, it is. It's absolutely horrible. I said, what would you do if you won $100 million? I said, I wouldn't want it. I said, I wouldn't even want to win. I don't want to win $100 million. That would be like disastrous, so to speak. Totally disastrous. He disagreed vehemently. He said, no. I can handle it perfectly well. I said, I wouldn't give a penny to anybody. So no problems. I said, well, all these people will come after you for money. He says, I don't care. It's no to everyone. He says, nobody's given me a penny in life. I've worked so hard for my money, and I'm so poor. And if I get the money, that's it. You know, I'm just going to, it's mine and nobody else's. I was like, huh. I said, well, if I get $100 million, I know who to give it to then, right? And he goes, yeah. but for me, I say, money's the root of all evil. You know, it really is. you do need it. I was told today, hey, you know, you ran out of money, and that's not good. And I said, that's not good. That is true. But, you know, it's also not good to be prepared right now. You know, it's more important to be Johnny on the spot right now than it is to have a big fat bank account. Big fat bank account's not going to protect us from losing our mind. You know, losing our mind and shifting downwards, psychologically shifting downwards. It's not going to prevent that. It's not going to prevent that at all. And you can't buy a positive spiral either. You can't buy it. It doesn't matter. The richest person in the world can't buy shifting into a positive spiral. They have to have technique. Right technique is required. How to stabilize your psyche. How to stabilize yourself when you make a massive positive shift, you know, into almost seemingly paradox land, so to speak. We're not used to that. We're not used to walking and chewing gum at the same time, able to, you know, function here in an absolutist perspective, and at the same time deal with this all this non-absolute garbage, pretending. It's quite difficult, actually. And so shifting in towards that situation is, you know, your psyche gets alarmed, actually, quite alarmed, and says, man, I don't know if I can handle this, you know, I don't know if I can do this. And it's, yeah, it's not easy. That's why so few have done it. It's not easy. Kudos to them, man. They're the head of the class, that's for sure. Yeah, already some that are definitely the head of the class and got it done. And that's a kudos to them. That's really extraordinary. But, you know, we're in a situation where we need to do it. So we need to get some positive, real super positive momentum, super confidence, super positive momentum. All the saber rattling, you know, it's just, you know, just okay. I said, you know, it's still going on. It's worse than ever. Ridiculous stuff. Saber rattling. Who knows? It could all happen too. You know, it's pretty nasty. I had a dream there on the night of the 19th of February, and then I woke up and decided to launch this, you know, cultural reset. It's terrible. Devastating tyranny is coming upon the world. Devastating stuff's coming. So, we don't want to focus on that at all. We want to focus on making a super positive psychological shift, super positive psychological shift. And maybe, you know, being a wish fulfilling tree for like 5 months. I think people can handle it for 5 months, 161 days, but maybe after that, they just can't handle it anymore. You know, just instant success, you know, I just can't handle it. You know, I can't handle it. Instant success, you know. I say it's difficult to handle, for sure. So we might be able to handle, we probably can handle some of it. Probably we can handle a certain amount of it, and then we'll want to go back to the ghetto of, you know, discouragement and failure, because that's what we're used to. And that's what our psyche is craving for. After a while, it starts craving, says, I want to go back home, you know. I want to go back to what I'm familiar with. You know, I know it's terrible, but I'm used to it. That's the whole problem. So, you know, people talk about breakthroughs, but they don't last that long, generally. It lasts a while, and then people say, the psyche said, I want to go back to what I'm used to. This is just, you know, it's too scary for me. This is what happens. 99%+ of the time, this is what happens. But when you have right technique, we've really been working at, you're doing the 90% of the tough work, then you may just stabilize that and say, you know what, I'm going to stay stable here, actually, for a while, and you just, you know, take it one day at a time. That's all. So that could happen. Yeah, maybe just, you know, wish fulfilling tree, you know, that's been talked about in history, that sometimes gurus or spiritual coaches, people, those here have function as a wish fulfilling tree. Whatever they ask for, you get it. It's pretty amazing, but it happens. People get enormous help. Avatar was that way. She just walked down the street and she'd tend to get a pull to like knock on a door. She'd knock on someone's door and says, is there anything I can do? You know, anything? I feel like maybe there's someone here who needs my help. And they say, oh yeah, got someone here who's like super sick. They're dying. And she goes, okay, you know, I'll help them out. And she came in there and healed them, whatever, or reestablished their equanimity, you might say, their functionality, you might say. And then she'd leave the house, as I say. So she would do that. It's just, yeah, just whatever it was calling to her, she'd just answer the call and bestow, you know, the gift, a gift, freely give an instant gift on people. That's why people, you know, are astonished and we ask, astonish us now. You know, we're willing to be astonished for a while, for sure. The avatar is not much just known about her. That, you know, these days it's getting lost and buried. You know, it really is just mother worshippers basically talking about her. But the truth is, there's just, you know, the avatar is just absolutely extraordinary beyond anyone's comprehension, actually. She'd just help out people at a distance, too. She'd be walking down a street and simultaneously, 1,000 miles away, be pulling someone out of the river that are drowning. Yeah. It's just spontaneously helping. So, you know, kind of like, it's like a wish-fulfilling tree. Whatever you asked, you know, she'd find a way, it would happen. It would happen, so to speak. Good, you know, positive stuff. She wouldn't do things that were harmful for you. And then later on, she kind of got away from that, at least any overtly doing that. Would do it anyway, but not overtly. But in the beginning, definitely would just be walking around and knocking on doors and meeting people, and she'd just meet people, and they'd say, hey, you know, she's got any trouble, she'd say, and they'd say, well, God, my relative, you know, is like, you know, and super in debt, or like really sick, or this or that, you know, I'm suffering a psychological breakdown. She goes, well, okay, let me go talk to them. And then she would go talk to them, and their problems would straighten out within a couple of days, or pretty soon they're just poof, gone. No more problems. No more problems that they had. You know, of course, they come back, they go crawling back to them, you know. Say, whoa, I'm not used to not having problems. I'm not used to instant success like this. So she just did, you know, gave innumerable benedictions in her time in the world, just innumerable. You can't even contain them in books. So much happened, actually. But this is so lost to the world right now. It's just, it's deplorable what's happened. But this can happen here. This can happen. This wish-fulfilling tree situation can happen, actually. Even animals can get some help, too. Yeah. So, since this is all pretending, there's nothing really that we can't do in terms of adjusting our pretending. But usually people go back to it and say, oh, I'm going back to what I'm used to doing. I'm good at it. I'm good at pretending discouragement and limitation and ruination. You know, I'm really, really, really good at that. I want to go back to that. This no pretending, this instant successing. You know, it's like, I'm not used to it. Not used to it. Well, we got to get used to it. So, you know, you just hang with it. So, you know, what happens next? I don't know. It's just the avatar's birthday on the 30th of April. So I asked her, you know, I don't want to get discouraged by asking for favors that don't happen, you know, but I would say, you know, the situation is as it is. It's not a joke. It's not a joke. It's not a joke right now. And so we were told accurately what's going to happen. I was told in advance about all this. I said that this 10 years of 2020 through 2030 are going to be just extraordinarily difficult, the most difficult time in history. It started out with the health thing. I said, but that's not it. There's other stuff coming. There's other stuff coming. Really, we've been in World War III for quite some time already in this world. If you think about it, World War III is very different than what we're used to. The stuff that's going on in the world as far as military and, you know, howitzers, you know, artillery and all this stuff, that's conventional warfare. But that's nothing compared to the other kind of warfare that's going on. Who are the big warfare? You know, where's the warfare going on? Well, look at social media. Look at technology. Look at some people have, like, you know, 100 million followers. That's like a great general with an army of 100 million people, actually. A psychological army of 100 million people. Okay. These are great generals, and they use these people in various different ways. Then you have people own the media companies who reach millions of people. Then you have the entertainment industry. These are all warriors. These are all armies, actually. This is warfare. Modern warfare is psychological warfare. Modern warfare is psychological warfare for the most part. That's where most of it, and that's been going on for quite some time, quite some time. And you got the situation now with, of course, the new owner of Twitter, who has a Twitter followers, as you know, 90 million plus. I'm sure it's going to go up. He's able to utilize that like an army. You know, he really is. Psychologically put pressure on people, narrative-wise, you know, they're able to shape narratives. So the modern warfare shapes narratives is what it does. And it may not be narratives that we like at all. It may be very damaging to us psychologically, which Jesus said, fear those who can shape your psychological narrative more than they can, you know, harming your body. Because psychological narratives, once shaped, can lead to a whole chain of births and deaths for you. A whole chain of births and deaths. A whole lot of births. Births and deaths, which is, you know, worse than losing your life just once. You may end up, you know, going through all this misery and suffering over and over and over and over and over again. So that those people are able to shape the psychological narratives, those are the real countries of the world. Those are the warring factions in the world. Those are the ones with the gigantic armies of 100 million people or such. And that's to be feared, so to speak. That's the real danger in the world. The other stuff is not nice either, right? We didn't say it's nice, but it's not as psychologically damaging. It's in terms of buying into a false narrative, being herded into a false narrative. That's the movers and the shakers in the world. There are people who have really very strong followings and voices in this world who can really shape narratives, no question about it. And that's what's going on. World War III is a narrative-shaping war with, again, extreme consequences. So we're right in the middle of World War III. If you know, it's not like we're waiting for it to start. It's already started. It's been going on for quite some time. You know, these the big tech companies, you know, they're shaping narratives like crazy, right? Absolutely they are. And how many users does Facebook have around the world? You know, that kind of thing. And Google search, how many people use that? So these companies are shaping the narrative of this planet on a planetary scale. It's a world war. And they are extremely focused and industrious in shaping the narratives that they want. And they may not; those narratives may not be the best thing for people at all, actually. Could be quite bad. In the past, we had the church, like the Catholic Church, shaping narrative. They still are, but they seem to be less successful than before, that's for sure. So they were capable of shaping a global narrative to a large extent. Not everywhere, but these tech companies reach, you know, even further, have a greater reach than the Catholic Church, for sure. Massive reach. So that's modern warfare, actually. That's what's really going on. The fight to shape your narrative in one way or the other. So, you know, this next 5 months is going to be a blitzkrieg by the narrative shapers. And this is crucial time. So something may happen. You know, something may happen. Yeah, something super positive may happen. I don't know. Don't count the Avatar out. She seems to be very quiet recently. Her post, the people who post online about her, the quality has dropped way down. And I just like, it's not good. It's not what it used to be at all. The whole vibe is not there anymore. So I'm saying, what's going to happen? Don't know. But, you know, literally, people could go around just touching people, just healing people, just random people, whatever happens to show up in their life, and you're healed. You know, it's like that. For now, I mean, it's not really healing. It's just being restored to, you know, a good functionality, you might say. How do you heal pretension? You stop pretending altogether, and then you're not even concerned about even having a body at all, actually. But as long as we're here, it's just establishing, reestablishing functional equilibrium, functional poise. You know, get back to being very poised. But again, it doesn't necessarily stick. That's not a knock against anything. It's just the facts, the pragmatic facts of how it works is we go back to what we're familiar with. So if you're not willing to put in the hard work of practicing, your poise will not last. Here, will not last. You will be unsettled by the seeming paradox of truth here. The way that truth seems to us, it seems to be paradoxical until you find out what's really going on here. And then it's no longer that. It doesn't seem that way to you anymore. But that takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of work. But, you know, it could generate a certain amount of optimistic momentum and shift things in a positive direction. It's possible. I mean, Jesus did that, walk around healing all sorts of people. Whoever came to him was healed, right? Just the sight of him healed people. So he decided to do that. To produce a certain kind of momentum when things were actually headed in a very nasty direction, which they were. Okay, they were about, I don't know, was it 40 years later or something, the Maccabean revolt or something, you know, where they, and it got it was real nasty. It's real nasty. Masada, was that Masada or something? That whole thing and this, they wiped out. You know, the siege of Jerusalem happened, got taken over, and then later on, what, 126 AD or something, then the final, was it Titus or something, came in and just wiped out the land, completely drove everybody out of there and burned everything, cut all the trees down, and just wiped the place off the face of the earth. So Jesus knew that these things were going to happen. So he produced this positive momentum that would help people go choose a positive shift, psychological shift, a really super positive psychological shift, so they wouldn't shift negatively during this, you know, terrible times that happened. And it worked. It worked. It worked. It absolutely did work. And so he would just go around, you know, healing anyone that wanted to ask for it. Boom, right away. You're healed. But we're saying now it's probably better that ease into it, you know, ease into it. But, you know, maybe some people say, you know, instantly. But ease, yeah, that's another style. You can do it that way, either way. And so people start talking about that. Say, wow, you know, what is this? You know, this, like, they got guts attention getter, you know, so. We need an attention getter right now. That is for sure. We need an attention getter in this world, a super positive attention getter, where we can just say, okay, you got your thing, we got our thing. It's like that. The two don't mix. The two don't mix. And so, you know, we just have to have our thing. That's all there is to it. And again, it could be instant success. When you realize you don't need any success at all, that is instant successing, actually. Instant successing. That is a psychological quantum shift, you might say. Yeah, psychological quantum shift. Realizing we don't need any success is instant successing. Wow. Instant successing. Wow. So, we're getting a good view rate. The first 15 viewers, I'm averaging like 40 minutes a video, or more than that, actually, which means people are really watching these videos, you know, at least halfway through. Halfway through, yeah. If not more, some more than that, you know, so that's really great. That means, you know, you're tuning into the vibe, actually, like, hey, you know, we've got things lined up, so to speak, in a certain way. Got a little landscape and the flowers planted. It costs quite a bit of money, for sure. And that's part of the problem. But it's you know, it's settled. It's beautiful. It's going to get more and more beautiful over the next 5 months. By the October 15th, it'll probably be the end of the growing season, somewhere around there. You know, depending how cold it gets. But it will just be a super bloom here. There'll be a lot of super blooming taking place here. And so I'm sort of, you know, that's just sort of an external representation of what could be a super blooming in the world, just instant super bloom for people. You know, don't wait for a seed, plant a seed and wait 2 months or 3 months until it germinates and starts growing, et cetera, et cetera. We got a super bloom right this instant. So realizing no need for succeeding is instant successing. Wow. No need for succeeding is instant succeeding. Wow. Just like that. When we realize we don't need to succeed, we don't need any obstacles, you see? Success means overcoming obstacles. When we realize we don't need to overcome any obstacles, we don't need to have any obstacles at all. Totally unnecessary. We don't need to succeed at all. What do we need the obstacles for? That's what we mean instant successing, because you realize, well, I don't need any obstacles. This instant, no need for any more obstacles, actually. So I'm walking through the backyard, going on the side, and suddenly I hear this commotion, these two mourning doves were right in front of me, and I startled them a little bit, but they just flew and landed on a fence, both of them real close to me. I stopped, I froze, and I didn't move. And they're just looking at me intently. I'm looking at them. Nobody moved. I stayed that way for a couple minutes, like this. Finally, I realized, I don't want to go through and disturb them through the gate, that, of course, they'll fly off in a sort of a panic or something. So instead, I very slowly eased backwards and out of their sight, and they didn't move. They're just watching me, and they stayed there resting quiet. It was like a moment of like super silence there. I just was totally silent, didn't move, and totally silent. They were also the same way. That was extraordinary. Nothing that like this has ever happened before, because they were real close. I was real close to them. Quite amazing that they didn't fly away, you see. Interesting. It means something. It really means something big time. So again, when we realize we don't need to succeed, we don't need any obstacles at all to overcome. So the obstacles then become meaningless. Except I don't need sickness. Since I don't need to succeed in any way, what do I need sickness for? Right? What do I need these troubles for? What do I need these struggles for? What do I need these obstacles, these needs and all these things? What do I need so I could become successful, you know, train myself in being successful? I don't need any success. So I don't need these obstacles. I don't need these challenges and troubles and anything like that at all. So again, the world may be able to handle 561 days of just freebies, you know, freebies for everyone. and then it'll start contracting again, you know, but it will never quite contract the same way. It'll be stretched out enough so the contraction won't be as bad as before, for sure. So that's a way to help out the world. Once you stretch out with instant successing, you're not going to go back to a real rigid, you know, I need to succeed philosophy. You're going to entertain a better philosophy. You're gonna be open toward, hey, maybe there's some work I can do that'll make this permanent for myself. Singing with the Beach Boys today again. I had my high voice for a while until I burned it out. That's pretty cool. I was singing pretty well. I had the high voice today. I was able to do it in a certain shape, my mouth shaping it, and so it came out right. You know, it's like, ah. But eventually it wears out. You know, I sing enough that way, and then you lose the high notes. You have to rest for a while. Vocal cords do get stretched out and get tired. But but of course, music is not the answer. It's not the answer at all, especially during these times. It's not enough. Not enough. I'll sing a song. If anybody wants to sing a song, I'll sing a song. You want me to sing a song? I'll sing a song. I just find the song on YouTube, put it on the stereo, you know, vehicle stereo, and just harmonize with it, and invite them to harmonize too. Sing along. Sing along. Let's just sing together. Let's sing this song together, kind of thing. Let's sing this song together. So if my voice is fresh in the morning, I could certainly do that, and don't burn it out through singing like for hours at a time. I can sing along nicely to anything. But that's another idea. But I said, that's not probably not as strong an idea as just, you know, giving people opportunity to just get advice on one issue. And just pick an issue as like ultimate importance to you, and I'll give you some advice on it. Or who knows, I'll give you a blessing or something if they have an affliction. Just, bless it and have it just, you know, ease away, you know, ease past it totally. Testing out the Buddha care, it works. Buddha care works. You know, I have tested it out. It does work. It does help us ease past afflictioning, no question about it. So it will help people. It will help people. But I don't know if I'm just going to actually, you know, tell people, I'll answer any question you want. Just give me one all important, a clarification you want, and I'll see if I can clarify it. I don't know if people are going to go for that or not. We'll see. Maybe not. I don't know what's going to happen, but something's going to happen for sure. It's like the next chapter in the world is going to happen. I mean, you get nuclear threats like we're getting. You need the next chapter in the world. There's no two ways around it. We are at that point where the next chapter in the world needs to take place. And we prepared for that. And starting in 1966, of course, and miracles, of course, began to be transcribed and started, that whole process started. And that was, of course, the Cold War, you know, the Cuban Missile Crisis was the last time we had a real nuclear scare, but we were, you know, Vietnam situation, but also the Cold War was intense, raging, and people, I think, felt like, hey, you know, maybe there's some point in the future this might get out of hand. This is what we felt back then. So, lo and behold, we were praying for some help. A Course in Miracles came in. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. And yes. This helped out a lot. I think a lot of the suffering that I went through and people went through, we were simply scared out of our minds by what could potentially happen with this arms race that was going on, the nuclear arms race that was going on. Now we're at a point where we might find out what happens. But fortunately, we have this familiarity with A Course in Miracles. I certainly have familiarity. and I'm at ease with it. I don't necessarily understand all of it or agree with all of it or really know how to exactly put it in the right context and 100%, but I'm very familiar with it and can work with it, you know, that kind of thing. So it's been helpful. I believe it was a preemptory situation knowing what is to come. It was a preemptory situation knowing what's to come. We're now at that point now in history now where we need the next chapter, you know, whatever that next chapter is going to be. And let it be whatever it is, and, you know, we'll handle it for a while. And then most people will say, whew, and I'll take a little break. You know, okay, that was a wild ride, or that was a cool ride, but, you know, I'm going to slow things down a little bit now. But, you know, that's how it goes. That's how it goes. And it's all good. It's all good. But we do need the next chapter now in the world. We really need it. That's all I can say. It's that time for the next chapter. And so here we are. You know, it's next chapter time. The saber rattling has reached the point where, you know, we just can't sit around. Oh, you know, we got to turn the page to the next chapter. It's time to turn the page. So we'll see who turns the page. You know, I don't know. Now, Coach Neelam showed out of the blue, you know, for me back there, and I think early, you know, maybe February 1st, 2020, Coach Neelam showed up out of the blue. Wow. What a blessing that was. What a godsend that was. Wow. So, yeah, it could be anything at all. It just happens. You just have to go with it. You know, it is what it is. We go with it. It's chapter turning, page turning time into a new chapter in the world. We're up for it. I feel up for it. My golf swing is good. I figured out the straight left arm is you just got to keep it straight. It puts strain on my body, but hopefully I can acclimatize myself to the strain. It works. There's no question. If you do it, it works. But doing it's the hard part. I can tell the swing is just beautiful when you keep that arm just totally straight and don't try to hit from the right side, but you use that, the left arm, sweeping the left arm through, and just use the right arm to kick through at the end, kind of, so to speak, but not controlling the swing. Got to let the left side control the swing, the golf swing. Then the right side comes in with the wrists and the speed, you know, just accelerates the speed at the last moment, so to speak, but doesn't try to take over up here. You know, got to keep the left side in charge, taking like that, and then right kicks in and poof, like that. It just smokes the ball. Just absolutely beautiful. So, got that, you know, got landscaping done, got the golf swing done, and got this taping done here, got the attitude done, got the clarity done, got our practicing going great, got that, you know, done as far as underway and everything. So, you know, it's chapter turning time in the world right now. And we're just staying tuned, you know, for what's our marching orders. I asked for marching orders today. So what's the, maybe the M is like, you know, marching orders. I want my marching orders today. Yes, we need marching orders right now, don't we? What are we going to do? What are we going to do? You got to turn the page. New chapter in the world. New chapter time. Could be, it could, yes, stuff could happen. Hopefully it does. Positive stuff, super positive stuff, that just people to say, hey, you know, there's something transcendently great. Doesn't matter what happens in the world. It's not, the world doesn't touch it at all. Doesn't, nothing that happens here affects something that this transcendent greatness that just, you know, is just cannot be diminished in any way, actually. Cannot be diminished in any way. Cannot be limited, cannot be subject to ruination, cannot be subject to any diminishment whatsoever, none. That's what we need to experience this, begin experiencing this. So however it shows up is fine, I don't care, it's just whatever it is, we'll just go with it, get used to it. It's like a golf course. You know, you show me a new golf course, I say, well, okay, let's get used to it. You know, of course it's going to be some unexpected, you know, difficulties and whatever, but you'll get used to it. You'll get around again and again and gradually get used to it. And after a while, you just feel like, you know, ah, yeah, I'm used to this place. I feel fine being here. So that has to happen. That has to happen right now. Has to happen. So I'm just advising everybody that, you know, that this has to happen. It's not maybe. It has to happen. We have to turn the page into a new chapter right now. We simply cannot stay stuck in the situation as it is right now. That is not on the table anymore. It's off the table. And, you know, stuff does happen. Chapters turn, like December 26, 1963. You know, I Want to Hold Your Hand, released as a single in New York. And after 10 days, the whole country was swept up into Beatlemania, and it didn't stop. Didn't stop for years and years and years, actually. And the talk about war, the Beatles, I mean, nobody had a bigger army than the Beatles. I mean, they were global. They had hundreds of millions of people throughout the entire globe that were Beatle fanatics, Beatle maniacs. And they utilized those, their fans, to reshape the narrative of this world. I mean, the Beatles probably did more reshaping of the narrative of this world than anybody in recent time. That is for sure. And they did it because they had all these fanatical followers. I mean, John Lennon said, we're bigger than Jesus. And he had a point to that. I mean, in terms of shaping narrative, the Beatles, you know, brought that to new heights in the history of the world. They probably had more effect on the narrative of this world than any part of modern history. For sure, they did. No question. Still going on. So there's a perfect example of an extremely strong power block there, reshaping the global narrative, and maybe in ways that we didn't want to have it shaped, actually. Yeah. Maybe in some ways people like, but there, you know, the ways that maybe, you know, weren't so good. I was in a store today, second time recently, they had classic rock. And I got sick. I mean, I'm music sensitive. I'm super attuned to music. So the music's playing like that. I could just feel it. And I was getting sick. I was getting psychologically trashed. I said, man, that is so terrible, the music. It's just horrible. It's cocaine. Cocaine and speed, amphetamines and all the drugs that people use. And the 70s and 80s, the music, classic rock time, it's nasty stuff. It's really toxic stuff. It's horrible. And I could feel the toxicity of it. It was just so extreme. I said, how do I even survive? Everyone I talked to who grew up in my era, we always say, how do we even survive that time, actually? It was so toxic. And they say, I don't know. I don't know how I did. I basically almost didn't, you know. And we can all say that. I almost didn't survive for sure. And now hearing the music, you can see the music's just horrendously toxic. It's horrible. I just got finished listening to Dion DiMucci singing with Dion. I go into the store and here's all this classic rock stuff where people are just, you know, they're just screaming it up with anger and toxicity and hate and aggression, amphetamine aggression, and just it was horrible in the early 70s, the crime in the inner cities, crime, things were just out of control. It was such a violent, aggressive, toxic time, the 70s, and then the 80s too, classic rock time. God. Horrible music. I had to grow up in that stuff. That's the stuff I grew up in. I mean, well, I grew up in the 60s, but in high school, then it was the 70s. And high school was too toxic for me. I couldn't handle it. The music just burned me out. Burned me out. Because, again, I am super musical sensitive. I can't help it. If I hear music, I just immediately am attuned to it. And if it's toxic, it poisons me. The music, you know, poisons me. It's terrible. Psychologically messes me up. But also listening to music does help me psychologically too, you see. So, but you go into a store, you got no control over the music, you know. I should be wearing, instead of wearing a mask, you wear earplugs, actually, for this stuff. And of course, now it's gone on and morphed into even more hideous stuff, you know, the whatever you want to call it. It's just like so ghetto-ish, you know, right now. It's so terrible. The guttural viciousness of it all. A lot of the music right now is even worse, but I don't listen to that stuff. You don't often hear it on, well, you do hear it modern times, actually. You do hear it more than you would expect, actually. You go to, like, sporting events and stuff, it just got this horrible stuff. Rap, hip-hop, all that kind of stuff. But and satellite kind of stuff that's going on. The whole music industry, that whole thing, it is so toxic. It's so extremely toxic. Yeah, I mean, we should be complaining that they're you know, psychologically poisoning us with that toxic music, actually, which is what's really going on. It absolutely is going on. Some people are just more aware of it than others, but that started in the 70s and 80s. It just got, you know, so toxic. It smoothed out a little, you know, going forward, for a while there. They're playing a bunch of songs. Every song they played, I just made me sick. God, I said, how did they survive this? How did they even survive? Well, basically didn't. Basically didn't survive it, you know. It's just, wow. God, why, you know? What a terrible thing to be super musical sensitive and then coming of age in the 70s and 80s music like that. What a terrible time. I mean, so the end of the 70s, like 79, I came across Blondie, which kind of helped me, because that music was starting to get back to something beautiful, and wasn't quite as toxic. The Cars, there was some stuff that was sort of, even though it was sort of new, it was punk, but it was going to new wave-ish thing, but it was also popish also, and it wasn't as bad as the early and mid 70s. It's then things kind of went, you know, ELO came along with a different sound, and stuff started changing, the music started changing, but for a while that the cocaine was just raging out of control, and the combination of all the drugs people took in the 60s combined with the cocaine and trying to stay high, you know, people just were irritated and angry and raging. And it's just, it was like, if you want to use music to make people sick, that's the way they do it. And it certainly made me sick, made me very, very sick, depressed. So music can tear you down. It can build you up a little bit, but it can tear you down a lot, actually. It's dangerous. It's something you don't rely upon music. You know, I thought music can make me happy, and my whole life was based on, you know, music and the atmosphere, the weather. It can make me happy. And then when music began going toxic, the amphetamine sound of the Beatles started, it was just a shock to our nervous system, severe shock. Rolling Stones came along, it shocked us. We were used to listening to much, much brighter and more peaceful music, you know. And so we were really badly shocked our nervous system from that, the British invasion, the Beatles. And it started a downhill spiral for me, because I couldn't find that bright happiness that I had before listening, like the Beach Boys, for instance, Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons, a lot of the music in the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s. It was just, you know, Dolce Vita, you know, it had this bouncy, beautiful, bright, airy, spacious sound, you know, to it that was just so nice. And then suddenly the claustrophobic, you know, big city amphetamine sound took over. And then ultimately that ended up in the 70s, hard rock, classic rock, hard rock stuff. It was just people screaming in agony, basically, you know. I'm suffering, I'm dying, I'm in agony, and I'm just going to, in the, like the lead guitar, I'm listening to it. That's how I used to play. I used to play that stuff. I could play, you know, the classic rock lead guitar styles really, really well. And it's like, oh God, it's horrible, you know. I used to play like that. I said, God, that was horrible to play like that. I was trying, how do I get free of it, you know? How do I get free of that? Yeah, it's awful to listen to it. I said, I can't believe, like, I'm ashamed I ever played that stuff, you know? I was just trying to cope with the music of the times and trying to make it more beautiful, but you got caught up into it, and it's just like frustration and nervous agitation expressing itself musically. It's not a good thing. this difference between like a hurricane and some, you know, beautiful billowy clouds floating by and just rainbows and stuff. You know, it's a different atmosphere. 70s like that, and some of the 80s was just this just intense storm atmosphere kind of thing. People were just angry. Holy cow. And we're back in a time now where people are very, very angry. And they're expressing it through music in various ways, which is, I don't listen to it. But back then, when you're in high school, you know, if you're super musical sensitive, you're into music was everything for me. It was my life, so I couldn't help but listen to it. Yeah, so it's a terrible thing. So don't count on music. It can turn bad in it really quickly on you. You might have some great music, and then boom, it goes so bad. That's what happened. And then you get pulled down. So music can only do so much, and it's very fickle, extremely fickle. Don't trust in it. Trust in your practicing. You can trust in that. You can rely on your practicing to go towards super positivity. Like no success is instant success. No need for success is instant successing. Wow. See, no need for success is instant successing. Wow. You can tell yourself that over and over and over. And that's way better than music, way more powerful than music. Music is just kind of ear candy sort of thing, but it doesn't. It's just the top 10%. It doesn't deal with the underlying factors that really are influencing us, how we choose to experience. That's affected by all the subconscious stuff. So. Turn the chapter again. You know, we've officially turned the chapter. Let's say May 3rd. Let's get ahead of the whole situation. Turn it right now. We're you know, officially turned the chapter now. Let's see what's next. Let's get ahead of the situation. Three days ahead of the situation is excellent. 4, 5, and 6. You know, that's good. That's good stuff. That's what we should be doing. Last time I beat it by 2 days. 20th, and their invasion happened on the 22nd. After Zelensky went and asked NATO for nuclear weapons, you see. Yeah, that was on the 21st. That's a nice way to get things started, right? So I, you know, put this global reset, this global initiative of a cultural reset, putting practicing first. That was on the 20th, because I knew something was going to happen within a few days. So I started that 2 days in advance. Let's see if we can get this cultural reset going, maybe three, this new, what you might call it, turning the chapter. Let's see if we get the turning the chapter here 3 days in advance. Well, we are doing it. We're bringing this forth, you know, even 4 days in advance. Let's say three. That's getting better. It's getting better. Instead of waiting till the last minute, don't want to do that. And anyway, not with this stuff that's going on. You don't want to risk in any way. We're doing it now. We're turning the page into a new chapter right now, right here, right now. The dog says something. Whatever. You know. So we may do this for a short while, 161 days, then maybe ease off of it for a while. We're not promising to be a wish-fulfilling tree forever. We just want to get some momentum going in the world, you know, just really get some momentum going. All important to feel upbeat, and say, hey, you know what? Something amazing's going on. There's something amazing's going on, really. Yeah, there's negativity, but there's also something just like really so amazing that I, you know, this is just feeling, you know, it's like I feel like the toxicity is kind of like at a distance right now. It's like it's not really decisive, is it? It's not really causative, is it, this toxicity? If there's something super positive that cannot be, cannot suffer any sort of decline at all. Cannot suffer any decline at all. How about that? Cannot suffer any decline whatsoever. Wow. So people ask, how can these spiritual coaches, how can you be in touch with them? Because they reached a point where they accepted that which can never decline. And the symbol of decline, limitation, ruination, the body, they didn't need that symbol anymore. Again, without any need, having no need for success, you don't need obstacles. So when their lifespan of the particular body was this time to drop it, they could have kept it if they wanted to. There's no point. They're already abiding in that which can never be diminished. And they say, that's what we really are. So of course they're not diminished in any way. They can communicate with us. They absolutely can communicate with us, no problem whatsoever. They're just waiting for our willingness, to communicate, to have a communication taking place. Dog is acting crazy there, howling in the background here. That's a sign, too, that the world is howling right now. It's going to a complete howling state. Yeah. And making some screaming music is not going to solve that. We used to do screaming stuff, in the 70s, late 60s or the 70s days. It's just screaming and screeching and, people are just, And that developed into all the different styles that we have, thrash and death and vocal rasp and just everything, just people just like screaming, in rage and in frustration, anger. Whereas before, it was like, how beautiful can you make the music actually? The ambience, how beautiful of an ambience can you make this song? Just the beautiful strings, and you're just floating on a cloud, it's just beautiful. That came mostly from alcohol, actually. That was the drug of choice in those days, was alcohol. The jet set classes, it was amphetamines, but most people, it was alcohol. So they sort of had this dreamy, romantic, floating in a cloud, just beautiful strings and soft horns, and beautiful singing and romance, and everything was, bright and cheerful and nice. And just, we tried to create an atmosphere, an ambience that just, it was basically after World War II, we wanted to create a super nice ambience in the world, right? So we just wanted to emphasize, the good and the beautiful and that, super, real, not super positive, but a real positive romantic ambience, like love is in the air, folks. Love is in the air. It's everywhere. Love is in the air. Ooh, love is in the air. I think that might be in the 60s or even the early 70s that love is in the air. But that was the feeling. Like, if we wanted to say, like, love is in the air, where is a classic rock, it was like anger's in the air. Fear and anger's in the air. Rage is in the air. Just forcefulness is in the air. Change, just real, real nasty change. And so, again, right now, we're not going to wait for some nasty change to take place. We're going to be the change, the change that's needed, the changing the chapter into super positivity, into that which can never suffer any diminishment whatsoever. And so how that presents itself, I don't know, but it's going to present itself in some way here. It's going to present itself. And so however it presents itself, we'll be open arms, say, great, It is what it is. We'll get used to it. That's a healthy psychological attitude. Judging is not going to do any good. It's here. I'm going to get used to it. I'm going to remove my familiarity bias from this, and then we'll go from there. That kind of thing. But that's a lot of work. I got to work at it. Removing familiarity bias is intense work. So just go to work. I got to the job site today that didn't have nails. I put up this copper flashing. Didn't have nails for it. Someone forgot to, talk about bringing nails. So the worker said, hey, I want those big fat ones with, and he's got the kind of roughness on them. What is that? And I said, oh, that's a ring shank. I said, they make ring shank roofing nails? And he said, yeah, you probably have some. So I went and looked. We have this big bag, huge bag of copper ring shank roofing nails for copper flashing like this. I was like, wow, I didn't even know we had those. They look beautiful, these bright copper, you know, is expensive using these, those copper nails with the ring shank, fat with the ring shank. So he's going to be really happy when those arrive on the job site. Like, yeah, it's exactly what I want. Cool, you know, it's like that. So we had it just there. I didn't, you know, hardly even know we had it. I just was searching for something. I got to find something. Like, there it is. So, you know, it shows up. What you need shows up. So we need something really big to show up right now, something really helpful, that which can never suffer diminishment. We need that to show up, plain and simple. You know, let's cut to the chase. That's got to show up in one form or another. We're not so picky. Beggars can't be choosers, right? And we're certainly beggars right now. We really are begging. And come on. It's like, I don't say that. We'll just, but we're begging, we're begging, we're begging, we're begging. Beggars not be choosers, accept what it is. It is what it is. Be well behaved, right? Like I was with those morning doves. Very spiritual symbol, those doves. I was just silent, quiet, didn't move. Very well behaved. Then after a while, I just quietly backed away from it, you know, so as not to disturb the situation. So I kept it, everything was smooth, everything was smooth. Everything was great and smooth like that. So we've established a rapport there, right? That, hey, there's a modus operandi, so to speak. We can function in that sort of situation appropriately. So, you know, romance isn't going to get it done. Even the most beautiful romantic music is not going to get it done right now. We have to experience that which can never suffer diminishment in any way. We have to experience that. We have to come in contact with that. We have to experience it. We have to remain in contact with it. We have to overcome our familiarity bias towards it right now. That's the job that we have, is overcoming our familiarity bias. And we have to get started right away on this. So those are the parameters. So I'm pretty darn interested in what happens next. Because I got some people coming after me probably for, why did I spend so much money? You know, that kind of thing. Why did I go for broke? Well, they don't understand. It's the time you got to go for broke right now. Again, it's chapter turning time. And you got to be ready to turn the chapter, period. At all costs. At all costs. I realize that. Said at all costs, got to be ready to turn the chapter right now. So no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just shocked by no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just allowing no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just accepting no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just delighting no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just loving no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just abiding in no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just no need for success is instant successing. Wow, just no need for success is instant successing. Wow. So you could call, you know, that which cannot be diminished, you could call it silence, because there's no diminishment of it. So it's saying everything continuously. That's what Ram Maharshi said. So it sounds like silence, he says, but it's actually everything is being said continuously. There's no diminishment of what's being said whatsoever. If there was a diminishment, then it would be noise. Okay, but this perfection from the standpoint of diminishment sounds like silence. But he said it's actually like a top that's spinning super fast. It seems to be motionless and still. But the illusion is because it's spinning so fast. He says really the silence is just super fast. All activity, everything's being done this instant. You know, it's just, this is why it seems like silence to us. Very great explanation from him. Very, very helpful and great explanation. So, congratulations, everybody that's still here. It's still, you know, there's about 30 people, 35 people, 35 of you still, you know, here. Sometimes 40, depends when you have the time. I know people are under incredible pressure right now, et cetera, et cetera. So, anyway, we'll see. We'll, you know, something, we'll see. And we'll just go with whatever it is. But again, it's a very clear mandate. We need to be in touch with that which can never suffer any diminishment whatsoever. And, you know, whatever format that wants, however it wants to present it itself, whatever format is fine with us, you know, just work to get used to it. That's all. So we'll just be absorbing. I didn't eat dinner tonight. You know, I was shocked by what I didn't pay attention how low I was money wise. I didn't pay attention. I just have to get it done. I got a project. I got to get it done. Hopefully I don't run out. I came within very close to running out. Absolutely. I was like, whew, almost ran out. But I got the job done. In time. That's the critical factor. So we'll see what happens next. And how does that which can never suffer any diminishment, how does it present itself to us at this point? That's it. Not really concerned. It's just got to be something, right? It's got to be something. So it is whatever it is. It is. It's got to be something. We'll look over the ocean today, Monterey Bay. Boy, the birds were so, the bait fish were in close, and there's just tons of birds. There were dolphins all over the place, and there was whales cruising up and down the coastline, close in. And my friend was in a kayak last weekend, and the whale jumped 30 feet out of the water, breached way out of the water. Like, you know, it didn't jump 30 feet. It was 30 feet away from him. Came out of the water and smashed down in the water and said it was like extremely dangerous, just really scary. He was really scared, he said. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? That's pretty darn interesting to have that happen to him. He fishes from a kayak out in the ocean, and the whale was just real close to him. And he said, what if that will come down on my kayak? You know, it's like, it got his attention really bad. But boy, the bait was just intense out there. The bait fish coming in close, and, you know, the fishing season, the salmon are out there, the halibut are out there. People going out there fishing a lot now, and it's fishing season. People are going after it. Pretty interesting. For us, again, we're, you know, resigned to our fate. You know, we have to turn the chapter at this point, have to experience that which can never suffer diminishment. That's the antidote to the times. It's the only real antidote there is. So again, you know, it is what it is. It's the times that we're in. We're here. We signed up for this, so to speak. And so, you know, it's time to, you know, go into the next chapter, just like that. I'll get my glasses some point soon, slightly different look, and ready for the next chapter, basically. That's how I feel, ready for the next chapter. It feels bound to happen, you know, it's just a certain, the times are such that it has to happen, you know, basically it has to happen. And we just feel like, we got no choice. And so look at it that way, you know, that's maybe the best way to look at it. We really don't have a choice. Stalling out's not a choice actually anymore for us. So we don't have a choice. We have to start, you know, being in touch with this and experiencing it in some format. Just got to. There's no choice about it. It's got to be done. You know, and people think like, I can't sleep if I think this way. I said, no, I'll be able to sleep. Maybe. If I don't, I don't. But should be able to sleep, just practice. You know, you do the wow practice to calm yourself down. My past as well, my present as well, my future as well. My past as well, my present as well, my future as well. My past as well, my present as well, my future as well. So no matter what happens, we experience that which can never experience any diminishment whatsoever. It's still wow. My past has always been wow. My present is wow. My future is always wow. So I just feel the sense of, you know, total continuity. it's always going to be wow. This is just, you know, a different format of that is wow, but it's, you know, it's wow. And to this day, it just smooths out your reactions. You're not so concerned. You feel, you know, poise. You feel a lot of poise. And it doesn't really matter, you know, how it presents itself. It's still, it's going to be wow. My past has always been wow. My present is always going to be wow. My future is always going to be wow. Look at it that way. And you feel calmed down. Feel a sense of inner poise for sure. So consistency with a golf swing is a less straight left arm. It is consistency. If you can do that consistently, you're going to hit consistently good shots. The key is, can your body handle that? Can you already start cheating and, you know, bending a little bit and then using the right side and all this kind of stuff? That creeps into your swing. It creeps into the swings. You know, how well can you just stay with that, you know, straight left arm all the way back, left side leading the whole swing? How well can you do that and then let the right side kick in at the right moment? Not too soon. Not too late. But, you know, it's very doable. And in doing it, you're going to hit consistently really good shots. You're going to look like a golfer out there, actually, when you do that. You really do. When I was doing that, my shots looked like, hey, I know what I'm doing. I'm going to look like a, you know, accomplished golfer. Just titanically high shots, just beautiful. Like, wow. The ball sounded great, too. It just whack. And that, you know, yeah, you do the right, just do the swing the right way, it's going to happen. So that's right here on cue, you know, right on cue, you know, I've got it. Yeah, you know, at least I know, you know, what needs to be done. So that's a good sign, very good sign, super great sign, super positive signs happening right now. And we're ready for that which can never suffer any diminishment. We're ready for it. So maybe we just quietly wait for it, just quietly wait for it. And just accept that it's saying everything continuously. It's doing everything continuously. It's all total action continuously. And it doesn't need to add anything because it's not being diminished in any way. So, if it, whatever it, is, it may say, it has to be put in the right context. There's no need for it to say anything, actually. And that it's normal state of silence. It's but it can say stuff, and that doesn't diminish it either. But it doesn't need to be what it is, to you know, to protect its non-diminishable status at all. It's not saying something to defend itself or protect itself in any way. How we doing here? Pretty good. 121, 161 days. Starting up on the 7th, we're gonna put our own blitzkrieg, a positive blitzkrieg, on the whole situation of super positivity, that which can never suffer any diminishment whatsoever. Okay, being in touch with that, and one way or another, being in touch with that. That's what we're gonna do. And you know, the world's gonna do what it's gonna do, right? Yeah, paranoia is gonna play the way it plays, but we are going to be in touch with that which can never suffer any diminishment at all. So silence is not a void. It's not a lack of happening. It's a total fullness of everything happening. And so there's no need to comment in any way, right? If everything's continuously happening, what need is there to comment on it? Words are a commentary, actually. Do we need to comment on that, actually? No, it's happening right now. It's always happening right now. Everything's always happening right now. Just total allness is happening. What need is there to comment on it? There isn't any need to comment on it. There's no need. Reality has no need to comment on anything at all. There's no point to it whatsoever. Never. But because of our, you know, mistake we made, attribution error, we feel, you know, some need for some commentary to kind of ease back into no need for any commentary whatsoever. Because we feel like, well, I don't want to know what to say. That's because we don't need to say anything. If everything's continuously happening, just as we want it to happen, well, what need is there to comment on it? You know, there's never a need to comment on it. The experiencing is ongoing, continuously ongoing. It cannot suffer any diminishment whatsoever. There's no need to comment. We're experiencing it directly each instant. There's zero need to comment ever. No, never any need to comment on reality, actually. So reality is not really commenting on itself. It's just helping ease us into realizing that we don't need to comment on reality either. Commenting is for the denial of reality. And why is it not working? You know, it's commentary on that. And so we gracefully, you know, ease into this. Just wow. Just stick with the wow. Past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. My past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. And you can keep yourself very calm in such a way. My past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. My past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. Wow. I need to do nothing. I am like wow. I need to do nothing. I am like wow. My past is wow. My present is wow, my future is wow, my past is wow, my present is wow, my future is wow. My past is wow, my present is wow, my future is wow. My past is wow, my present is wow, my future is wow. Yeah. So great. Very, very, very great. Just practice in this way and you will feel this inner poise dawning upon you more and more. So we're down to just one commentary on both our past, present, and future, which is just wow. And then from there, it's easy, much easier to go into just no need for any commentary whatsoever. Reality never has any need for any commentary. So by simplifying our commentary on both the past, present, and future to just wow, this really puts us in the catbird seat, puts us in a great position to get in touch with that which can never suffer any diminishment whatsoever. So, you see the effectiveness of this wow practice now? Very effective. Very, very helpful. That is for sure. Past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. That's the total commentary. It encapsulates all possible commentary. We're just encapsulating in this one commentary. Past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. Whew. Yes. So, you know, stay disciplined. I'm not going to go eat any ice cream right now. I might eat something because I haven't had any dinner. Probably have like a cheese sandwich or something. Peanut butter and cheese sandwich. And probably need to eat something. But I've just been kind of shaken up by the severity of the situation we're in right now.